Good morning, and thank you so much for being here. This is Nebraska's news, weather, and traffic station, but certainly there are plenty of times when we wrap our 50,000 watts across the Midwest around our friends from Iowa, especially since the Iowa caucus is a lot closer than you think. And it's a pleasure to welcome into the studio a presidential contender who has an impressive resume, Nikki Haley. Welcome to News Radio 1110 KFAB. It's great to have you here.
Good morning. Thank you for having me.
You've got an impressive resume. Governor of South Carolina, ambassador to the United Nations, wife, mother, in no particular order. It's a great resume. It's got to be a little frustrating to have all of these wonderful highlights in your resume, and then people talk to you and go, all right, let's talk about Trump all the time. Is that a little frustrating?
You know, we haven't had a lot of that. So, you know, we had thousands of people at the announcement in South Carolina. We've since been to New Hampshire, Iowa. We're here, you know, again. And everybody wants to talk about moving forward. They appreciate and respect what the president did. We all know he was the right person at the right time. But they want to leave the drama of the past, and they want to go in a new direction. But they also understand that it's time for a new generation. That's what we're trying to focus on.
Some of them certainly do. Based on CPAC polling and other things that are out there, the former president still has an ardent group of supporters, as you know.
Yes.
So how do you court them and say, let's give Nikki Haley a look here as we get towards the primary season?
Well, you talk about the things that matter. You know, you said I was a two-term governor. We took a double-digit unemployment state, and we turned it into an economic powerhouse. I went to the United Nations. I didn't deal with one country. I dealt with 193, and we took the kick me sign off of our backs. But this is a time where we really need to focus on what matters. Look at our economy. We're $31 trillion in debt. We're borrowing money to make our interest payments. And the hard truth of it is Republicans and Democrats both did that to us. You need a president that's going to stop the spending. You need a president that's going to get us back on track. I did it as governor. We can do this in our country. Look at education. Our kids have fallen so far back, we don't know how we're going to catch them up. You've got, you know, cartels on the border. We're seeing fentanyl come through. You've got crime on our streets. And you, whoever would have thought an American would look to the sky and see a Chinese spy balloon looking back at them? We're in shambles, but Americans deserve better. And we had hundreds of people show up in Council Bluffs last night. They sure know how to make a girl feel good. And we talked about solutions. We talked about where we're going to go, how we're going to do it. And I'm telling you, America's ready. America's ready for a new generation. America's ready for a fighter. And America is ready to put the old status quo of the past and start getting forward with new leadership.
The Pottawatomie County Republican Party, great people there. I know they were very excited to have you at the Thunder Bowl last night off of I-80 and the illustriously named Madison Avenue there in Council Bluffs. How was your bowling game? Did you bowl last night?
I didn't get to bowl last
night.
But we had
frames?
A great right. group of farmers that we talked to. Then we had, you know, hundreds of people showed up, but we talked about some fun things. And, you know, we had a great time. We're going to be in Nevada tonight. And so good times ahead.
And you're doing some events across the state with Senator Ernst. So you're going to be a busy girl here for the next few days across Iowa.
Listen, no one's going to outwork me.
Well,
no one's going to outwork me. And we're going to work hard to earn every single person's vote in Iowa. And we're going to do the same in New Hampshire and South Carolina.
The weather will hopefully be a little better for you in the next few days. We're a long way from Myrtle Beach here, aren't we? We're a long way from Kiowa.
Let me tell you, this South Carolina girl's skin is thin, but if I can show up in Nevada, I think that the people can show up in Nevada. So I hope they'll come out and see us. We're looking forward to it.
Talking here with Ambassador Nikki Haley, as you were a two-term governor of South Carolina, you had to have been dismayed like the rest of the country was with what happened to the South Carolina residents who went down for a medical procedure in Mexico. And we know what happened. We kind of know what happened at that point. We know it didn't end well for them. And there's still a long way to go here. But this conversation has to do with healthcare costs in this country, has to do with border security with Mexico, has to do with the safety of the Mexican people. So, you know, as president, these are issues that you will be tasked with. You want to solve them here this morning?
Absolutely. So what I'll tell you is, first of all, we've got to get border security. We need to pass what I did in South Carolina, Arizona-style E-Verify across the country. That was basically saying no business could hire anyone that was illegal. It stopped the flow into South Carolina. We could stop the flow into this country. We need to look at the fact that we've had enough fentanyl cross the border that would kill every single American. But where's that fentanyl coming from? It's coming from China. We need need to hold them account. Mexico doesn't want to do anything about the cartels. Guess what? If they won't do it, we will. We need to send our special ops over there. We need to treat them like ISIS. We need to take them out the same way we took out ISIS. And we need to start looking forward and saying, what else are we going to do? You know, look at last year, we gave $46 billion in foreign aid. When I was UN ambassador, I told President Trump to stop giving foreign aid to countries that hate us. Let's start having the backs of our allies and holding our enemies to account. Why are we giving money to Iraq, who's basically holding hands with Iran that says death to America? Why are we giving money to Pakistan? Why are we giving money to Belarus holding hands with Russia? Why are we giving money to China and communist Cuba? We've got to stop that. That's the reason we need to get term limits again. We need to have mental competency tests for people over the age of 75. We've got to call out Republicans and Democrats for all of the spending that's gotten us into this hole. And we need to start building things in America again. We can do this. I did it in South Carolina. I did it at the UN. I know we can do it in America.
Some people think that you're anti the elderly when you say that. We need competency tests. Just because you're saying that, my interpretation is that, you know, it's not an automatic that you would fail the competency test. I mean, the strongest person in U.S. government right now is Senator Chuck Grassley. He's 5,000 years old. He's a tortoise. So when you're saying that, is that aimed at anyone in particular?
Well, let's first say that Senator Grassley would take that competency test without any question, and he would pass it with flying colors.
While doing push-ups, yes.
Absolutely. And he has a great Twitter feed, by the way. So, you know, you look at that. But what I'm saying is I'm not targeting anybody. I don't care if you do mental competency tests for people over the age of 50. But look at Biden last year. Look at Biden this year. And when you talk about someone that is making decisions on our national security and the safety of our families, when you talk about someone who's deciding how to deal with the budget, which, by the way, today he's going to say the way we deal with our budget in this financial crisis is to raise taxes.
On billionaires.
Absolutely. Yeah. Like, why are we okay with that? I'm saying let the people know if you pass it or not. Doesn't mean that they don't serve, but it lets the people know whether they pass it or not. Why do you have to be 80 years old to serve in Washington, D.C.? I don't mean disrespect with the mental competency test. I mean the fact that we should take it this seriously, that we should know when we send someone to Washington, that person is ready to play ball.
When we talk about age here, it gets me a little dismayed because you're the first real presidential contender that I've ever talked with who we would have been in high school at the same time, which is interesting, but at the same time makes me a little sad because not only do you look a lot younger than I am, but you're so much more accomplished than I am when we would have been growing up at about the same time.
So do you mean to tell me that you think I'm in my prime? You know, 'cause some people don't think I'm in my prime, by the way.
Yes, I look forward to your conversation with Don Lemon from CNN. We're talking here with Ambassador Nikki Haley, and I look forward to addressing a couple more lighthearted conversational topics before we cut you loose here this morning. But, I mean, everything you just said there, I mean, when it comes to spending, when it comes to jobs, when it comes to drugs coming across our border, it'd be great if we can get American people to stop taking drugs, cut off that pipeline. That's something you can do on your own time and get back to work in this country, which would do something to help the staffing shortages, which would hopefully do something to tame inflation. I mean, these are the issues that Americans say, look, I like some of these socially liberal policies, but my gosh, I'm tired of paying for all this stuff.
Well, and you know what? Republicans and Democrats are to blame. They started this COVID stimulus, passing $2.2 trillion. Democrats are just finishing it. So what happened? You had the first big stimulus package, and look at how people voted. You had 419 to 6. Basically voted in favor. 96-0 in the Senate voted in favor of it. And what did they do? They expanded welfare. Now we have 90 million people on Medicaid. You've got 42 million people on food stamps. That's not what we want. In South Carolina, we took 35,000 people off of welfare and put them to work. We need to quit paying people for sitting on the couch. We need to understand that people need to be a part of the solution. And that means they work. That means that we stop the spending. That means we stop the borrowing. That means we balance a budget. And once we start to focus on things like that, that's when Americans will feel strong and proud again. That's why I'm doing this. I look at my kids and I see my daughter, she's engaged, and I see how hard it is for them to afford a home. I look at my son, he's in college, and I see him writing papers about things he doesn't believe in just to get an A. We need to snap out of it. Why can't we move forward? We need to put aside the pundits and what they're saying. We need to quit telling people what we're going to do and how we're going to do it, because we know that. And we need to start focusing on what it means to love America again. Stop the national self-loathing. Let's go forward and let's start solving problems.
As soon as you start slapping people's mouths off of the government teat, you get howling. Whether it's the current incentive not to work in this country, or you talked last night at the Thunder Bowl in Council Bluffs about perhaps letting someone at some age now, not near retirement now, at some point we need to raise that age when you be eligible for Medicare, when you be eligible for Social Security. And the howling has already begun. CNN's ripping you up one side and down the other this morning on their website. So there weren't any specifics in that speech last night. Do you want to provide a few more details?
Absolutely. So first of all, when it comes to our economy, yes, we make things in South Carolina again. But with Biden saying, let's raise taxes, that's a lazy way out. Let's claw back the $500 billion in COVID money that has yet to be spent. Let's go back and look at the $100 billion of COVID fraud. And instead of IRS agents going after innocent Americans, go after that COVID fraud and let's get it back. Let's stop the earmarks. No more spending. Let's stop the borrowing. And then let's go and look at entitlements. What I said, and CNN doesn't want to say, is I said, we don't touch any seniors and we don't touch anyone that's near retirement. My parents are in their 80s. We take care of them. I don't want to hurt anyone in that age group. I'm talking about like my kids in their 20s. Let's go and change the retirement age for them so that there is something for them in the end. Let's go and make sure that we limit the benefits for wealthy Americans. That's how we'll get it back on track. Instead of going cost of living increases, let's do increases by inflation. That's something Republicans and Democrats will agree with. And then let's go and expand Medicare Advantage and create more competition, because seniors like that. That gives them more opportunities, and it will give better quality of care and cut costs. That's how we do it. You do it with solutions. I've done it. I'm not a lawyer. I'm an accountant, and I know how to get things done. We did it with our pension system in South Carolina, and this is how we would deal with entitlements going forward.
I wish I could talk to you all morning. We don't have that luxury this morning. We got a couple more minutes here with Ambassador Nikki Haley. As UN ambassador, this is a question I've been most interested in asking you about from a foreign policy perspective. What should America's stance be right now with Russia in their latest invasion of Ukraine?
Well, think about it. This really started with Obama. When he allowed them to get into Crimea, that sent Putin a green light that, okay, maybe we could do more. Then you go and you have the debacle in Afghanistan, you know, where we basically left Bagram Air Force Base in the middle of the night without telling our friends who stood shoulder to shoulder with us for decades because we asked them to be there. Think about what that told our friends. More importantly, think about what that told China and Russia, right? And then you go, and Russia did exactly what they said they were going to. They invaded Ukraine. This is bigger than about Ukraine. This is about a war on freedom, and it's one we have to win. That doesn't mean we send money to them. That doesn't mean we put troops on the ground. It means you make sure with our allies they have the equipment and the ammunition to finish this. Because if we win this, you won't see China invade Taiwan. You won't see Russia go into Poland and the Baltics and create a world war. If we lose this, we are getting into a bigger war. It's why we need to strengthen our military. I'm the wife of a combat veteran. He deployed in Afghanistan. A strong military doesn't start wars. A strong military prevents wars. We need to make sure that we finish this once and for all and set the tone on what we want to do. It's peace through strength, and it's getting the job done.
Finally here, Ambassador, in your role as wife, you met a guy named Bill Rock Around the Clock Haley. I've heard the story that you told him you didn't like his first name. You decided to call him by his middle name, and that's why we know him as what, Michael?
Michael.
Did you do that to this man?
So first of all, it wasn't that I didn't like his name. We met my first weekend at Clemson. We've dated for 7 years. We've been married for 26, and he was known as Bill. And I looked at him and I said, what's your name? And he said, Bill. And I said, no, what's your whole name? And he said, William Michael Haley. And I said, you don't look like a Bill. I said, I'm going to call you Michael. And so it stuck. And so now he goes by Michael. So everybody pre-college calls him Bill. Everybody post-college calls him Michael. And I think he looks like a Michael. And he's a cute one, too.
You changed the man's name.
I didn't change his name. I just chose a different part of his name.
This is a question I love asking people, and there is a wrong answer to it. And this is my biggest judge of character on anyone. What kind of music do you listen to? And now I'm going to give you the wrong answer because I respect you. The wrong answer is, a little bit of everything. I'm going to need artist names.
So before I announced her president, I was listening to Ozzy Osbourne and Post Malone.
Oh, my gosh. Lucy Chapman over here is a big Ozzy Osbourne girl.
Before I came in here, my mojo music, I had two songs going. I had Dancing Queen by ABBA, and I had The Final Countdown by Europe. So I am a massive music buff. Music makes me happy. I think more people need music in their life, and you can't have too much of it.
I appreciate that answer. Finally, Ambassador, we ask all of our favorite guests on this program to say a line for us that we feel is the best thing you can hear first thing in the morning. And you would be, I think by my count, the second presidential contender to say this line after Dr. Ben Carson. Would you mind saying, the line is, good morning, honey, I made you pancakes for breakfast, made popular by our very own Lucy Chapman here. But because we've got the big Iowa caucus coming up, would you, Ambassador, please say, good morning, Iowa, I made you pancakes for breakfast.
So this is the problem. I can't cook. I can't cook. Honestly, my husband will tell you that I'm horrible. The only thing I can make is cereal.
It's flour, water, you stir it, you put it on the pan.
I mean, I even tried to make cookies out of the, like you put them on a pan and I burn them.
You make cereal?
I make cereal. Okay. I can do cereal well.
All right, so how about, good morning, Iowa, I made you your favorite type of breakfast cereal for breakfast.
Good morning, Iowa, I made you yogurt and raisin Special K this morning.
Wow. That's a fancy breakfast. Ambassador, thank you very much for all the time today. Good luck breezing across Iowa in some instances with Senator Joni Ernst. Tell her we said hi. We're big fans here on 1110 KFAB. And I hope you'll be coming back to Iowa throughout, especially during the summer when it gets too hot around here.
Not too hot. You know, in South Carolina, we don't sweat, we glisten. So I'll tell you that, Iowans, listen, let's have the courage. Let's get our country back. Go to NikkiHaley.com. Join the movement. If you have friends and family that are going to be in Nevada, send them out to us. We have a great time. We play great music. And we'll work hard to make America strong and proud again. Thank you.
You're welcome back here anytime you're in town.
Thanks so much.
Thank you very much. Ambassador Nikki Haley, presidential contender, NikkiHaley.com. And we will rejoin a conversation about a few other things.